there is nobody to increase on their power and to harness it up, they will lose all their shaktis. Let me tell you one thing. The devatas thrive on what we give them. When you pray to the devatas, and I'm not talking about the gods, I'm not talking about Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. I'm talking about the devatas, the Indra devata, Varun devata, Agni devata. When you pray to them, you provide them with a sustenance, we provide them with a shakti. See, you also talk a lot on the Bhagavad Gita. So, if you remember, there's a shloka in Bhagavad Gita which says that when you give, in Gita, not Bhagavad Gita, Gita, it says, Krishna tells Arjun that when you give sustenance to the gods, they return it to you, they get their energy from it and they return it to you in form of favors. So first, you have to give them that sustenance. And when we are giving that sustenance and there's nobody to harness it, so that sustenance is going waste. Neither you are able to utilize, you are not able to grow, or neither are you going to return it to somebody to help him or her grow. Mm-hmm. So that is what happened then. So Jupiter said that I want my wife back. So Indra tried, so many people tried to, you know, ask Tara to return, but she refused. And Chandra also refused that I'm not going to send her back to her husband. Now, this was a very delicate situation. It required careful handling. So as a result, Brahmaji was approached and there was a major battle. There was a major fight and everything, but nothing came to conclusion. But when Brahmaji intervened and he stepped in and said that it is high time that Lady Tara goes back to Brihaspati, Tara had to return to her husband. But by that time, she had already conceived a baby from Chandra. And that baby was Mercury. Initially, Brihaspati was very upset about it. But when he saw the baby, the countenance of the baby, the beautiful baby with its glowing, you know, Mercury as a child was a very beautiful child because he was born intelligent. So when he saw that, he accepted the child as his own. So we come to a lot of conclusions. Unhappy marriage is one of that conclusions here. So we come to unhappy marriage because of whatever Lord is present there, that we'll see how it tends to do it for, you know, anybody. And then it is also fostering. You learn to foster. You are a kingpin in the sense you are a maker, power maker. You have that in you to be a power maker, to be the pillar behind somebody, the strength of somebody. Okay, and you also have the ability to be a spiritual guide to people. You are a teacher, a counselor. All these things can be seen. Now, let us take up a few examples to check it out. See, Prince Charles. Prince Charles of Wales. So, it's a well-known fact, a very well-known documented fact. He's the eldest child, an heir apparent of Queen Elizabeth II, and he's the longest serving heir apparent in British history. His mother has been the longest serving, princess, the queen in history, and who's held that position since 1952. Both of them, she became the queen in 1952 and he became the prince. Okay, well, you know, it's there in Wikipedia that within 4 years of their marriage, Prince Charles went back to his former girlfriend, Camilla, who is now his wife, is now become his wife. And at the same time, Lady Diana, she went on ahead with the relationship. So those are very well documented by the paparazzi. And you see the ascendant here, which represents the self, is in Pushya Nakshatra. And the Lord of the Nakshatra, that is Saturn, is sitting in the second house of family. And the Lord of the Nakshatra is also the seventh Lord and the eighth Lord. Seventh Lord is the Lord of marriage, partnerships. and the eighth lord of candles.
Perfect.
And then we move on to Phyllis Diller. She is a very well-known, reputed comedian. Okay, and she, the makeup was so very loud that you could see that makeup with glares on. Not just the makeup in terms of the makeup on the face, but her dress and everything as a comedian was very loud. And she was a very accomplished comedian at that. But here she says that success for her came at a price. And what would that price be? The price is marriage of 26 years broke up. And then another marriage of 10 years broke up. So her job, her, you can say, her own career took a toll of her marriage. See, Saturn, which is the 10th lord of career and 9th lord of higher learnings, 9th lord of bhagya of marriage, you know, legality of marriage. Third house is the bhagya of marriage. Nine lord of bhagya of legality of marriage is sitting in this nakshatra. And she says that she's missed time spending with her children. It's because Mercury, which is himself a small prince, and top it all, it's the lord of the fifth house of children and second out of house of family. See, I'll take up a point here with everybody that we cannot just say that, you know, it's a bad thing happening here. Yes, I agree that she missed out time with her children and family. And she had she had to let go of her marriage. But those were jivas or live things. The one with the jar or which is not live factor. Take it as achievements, public platform, wealth, appreciation, power and knowledge. Okay, all that we can see from Saturn and Mercury associated is what she has got. She has achieved by this nakshatra. So no nakshatra, no planet is 100% white or 100% black. They will have their flip sides and their good sides attached. So we need to go and check out what is the flip side, what is the good side. And today I'm getting a little more carried away, but I will take this platform, Bhavaji, to say that there is free will associated as to where we can actually turn a few things in our favor. Because even in the Gita, and I repeat, I'm sorry for being repetitive, he says, karmanne vadhikaraste ma phaleshu gadachana. You have the right to do your karmas. Only the fruits we are not, because we are so much, if I do this, I will get this. We are so attached to the fruit that we forget the doing part properly.
Yeah, in this context only, as they say, na, if you have too many prominent planets, too many exalted planets sitting in the Kendra especially, then that's a very big problem, because then they are pulling you to 10 different directions. Then where do you go?
Yeah, not only that, if you have like Sri Ramchandra Ji's chart, very much prominent chart where he has so many planets in Kendras, right? Exalted planets. He has, his Lagna has, his Cancer Lagna, Pushya Nakshatra, and Punarvasu Moon, and Jupiter, he has Jupiter exalted.
Yes.
Right? He has a Saturn exalted. He has a Mars exalted and he has a Sun exalted. And his life was only living by the rule book, only doing what was correct. His personal life was so hampered. So too many ati sarvatra varjate. Too many good things are also not good.
Maybe only Lord Ram can handle them.
True. That is, and you know, Ravan also had this combination. Do you know that? He also had a lot of exalted planets. But one bad deed of his, if you want to read about it, do read Gopesh Kumar Ojaji's Phal Dipika, translation on Phal Dipika. Very beautifully written, where he says that one bad deed, you know, can actually bring about your downfall, because your free will, your planets then refuse to work in your favor. Ravan was the most intelligent man in his era, the most biggest bhakta of Shiva in his era. But his abduction of Sita, his mistreatment of just give me a second to recall. I do not recall the name, but his mistreatment of Kuber's sons to be wife. Those things gave him those ladies gave him so many curses that the planets turned against him.
Yeah, the Ramayana details that there are 18 curses which he had got in different places. And how finally when he abducted Sita, all those 18 fell perfectly into the place and he had it.
So it was the mechanism started rolling. He was even cursed by Parvati ji because he tried to lift the mountain Kailash.
Oh, is it? He was cursed by Parvati also.
The ladies brought about his downfall. Mandodari repeatedly told him not to, abduct Sita, or told him to let her go, but he didn't. And that actually killed his entire lineage.
I don't know where his Venus was. Maybe in the 8th house.
I had it somewhere around. I would have it where his Venus is. I'll let you know later. Okay, so we've seen this chart. Let's go ahead with the next. I hope people are not getting bored with this, because today we have discussed things beyond the scope of the nakshatra also.
No problem. They will also enjoy.
Okay, so we move on to Deepak Chopra. Deepak Chopra, everybody knows who Deepak Chopra is. Okay, and he is the philosopher, the business guru, advisor, counselor, you name it, he is it. Of the, the who's who. At one time, the who's who of the celebrity group of the council, and of the world over were part of his directory, and they loved him. They treated him as their guru, and they learned a lot from him. Something he taught a lot. A doctor himself, he is a doctor, but he moved on to alternative medicine, and he taught inspirational books. He'd written in holistic health and so many things. And if you read his books, they're quite convincing. They're quite convincing, and they can help you in a number of ways. Not changing the, your medical history, but changing your mind frame, which in turn has a very positive effect on your body and soul.
And he also has the most famous yoga, which Yudhishthira Maharaj had, Dharma Karmadhipati Yoga.
Yeah.
9th Lord, 10th Lord,
linked together.
Conjunct in the 9th house itself. Fantastic, this is. Oh, sorry, it's in exchange.
Yeah, so that's an exchange. Yeah, 9th and 10th Lord is an exchange.
And Parivartan Yoga is the highest form of yoga, so that's even better than conjunction also. Yeah. Fantastic, it is.
And you see that here it is sitting actually in Venus. Again, it's sitting with Ketu, which is also the lord of this house of Scorpio. Scorpio has two lords, Mars and Ketu.
Yes, yes.
So one exchanges, the other is sitting. A very strong yoga for him.
Fantastic.
His ascendant goes into, his Lagna lord goes into the 6th house of service. Of medical health care is a 6th house issue, and mental health care also. And it's the 12th lord of international fame, traveling. Counseling is something Pushya people are very good at. So they would be very good counselors because they can understand the psyche. And it has no aspect from any malefic. Even
this,
though his
son had made him quite wealthy also, because I see the Sri Lagna is conjunct there with this yoga in the 9th house, and
yes,
Saturn is of course there in Pushya.
and you see his son may be debilitated. It's the 7th lord debilitated in the 9th house. So people can say that he may not get that much of name fame, but one of the first Indians to make a huge name of himself. abroad. You know, professionally being very, very in a time when the now you come across number of Indians who have made inroads into the Western world. But he was one of the first few to having in modern city-starved West actually had found sustenance, because Deepak Chopra's teachings were very, very effective. I mean, for people who want to put it into practice, read his books, go ahead. Even Indians can benefit a lot because he's made it very simple, very, very simple.
Yeah, and this dispositor moon is also in the 8th house. And that also shows bringing up occult things and all those things.
Yes, not occult, it's transformation, change. And see, it's Vipreet Raj Yoga operating.
Yes, yes.
6th lord in the 8th house.
And the GL is there, so he'll have lots of power and position because of that.
Yeah. So he's good at it. He's really good at it.
Fantastic.
So we move on to another chart. We move on to the chart of Ernst and Stummelt, and he was born in Switzerland. He was a very beautiful musician, very, very beautiful musician. But before that, he was a maths teacher. So this nakshatra, Jupiter again sitting, exalted Jupiter. It's the second and the fifth lord sitting in the ninth house of higher learning. Second lord of education, wealth, and fifth lord of entertainment, sitting with the Lagna lord. So that gave him so much of money, entertainment, so on, so forth. So many things that he got from there. We move on to, now let us, this is a very beautiful topic that we should have covered right in the beginning or somewhere, but we're covering it now. Babaji, you told me that Rahu moves into Pushya, you know, pretty soon. So we need to know about what its effect could be. It can, you know, people have a very, very, very afraid, fearful approach of Rahu or Ketu movement. But it need not always be like that. Let's take up this natal chart of Louis May Alcott. Very beautiful, you know, writer, one to break barriers in life, in the sense that she, one born in 1832, and she was the one who brought her family back from the brink of bankruptcy. She started writing to help her family move out of the financial constraints. And a lady in that age and time, in 1832, it's like nearly 200 years ago. You know, 10, 15 years short of 200 years from now, the situation was not the same as it is today. Definitely never the same. But nevertheless, she brought her family back from, you know, a very bad financial situation to a very prominent standing. Rahu, which is an expansive planet, placed in Pushya, which nourishes. Again, let's not forget that it nourishes. So whichever thing is sitting in Pushya is nourished. So it's right there at the brink of Pushya, 3 degrees, 52 minutes. And there you see that it gives her the power to help. 12th house of international fame. 7th lord. Rahu is the co-lord of Aquarius, moving into the 12th lord, 12th house. 7th lord is public platform. 7th house is also, you know, acclamation's secondary house of profession. And that moves into the house of international name and fame. But it also gave her depressive tendencies, which is the flip side of it. Because 12th house is also, you know, insomnia, and it is also depression, mental issues. But that is on the flip side. She gained a name and fame that has lasted for more than 200 years. Nearly 200 years and more to continue. Her little women and little men are very famous books which have found translation in so many languages across the world. Now, Lord of the Nakshatra, again, Saturn is sitting in the second house of wealth, second house of fame, education, not fame, but education, wealth, family. She used her writing skills to save her family. So Rahu did take her to a different level. So when Rahu is moving into Pushya, we need not be afraid. Rahu does have a positive side, and that positive side is spirituality. On the negative side, it creates a lot of hallucinations. It creates an enigma. So it's like we all have heard about that poem and the story where a spider invites a fly into their home, into its home, and says that, "You please come in." So the fly says, "No, I don't want to come in because you will eat me." He says, "No, I'm calling you into my drawing room. You have a seat and we will enjoy." And the fly very innocently moves in and gets stuck in the web and is dead. And then the spider eats it. So on a lower octave, that is how Rahu functions. It gives you a lot of illusions of something to come, something to happen, which may not happen. But if you are not taken up by that illusion, if you just say that, if you pray to Rahu and say that, "Please guide me to my spiritual path," constantly, if you keep doing that, you will be guided. It is one of those planets which ultimately may give you the release, because it is through Rahu that our karma gets released. So it can be a guiding factor.
Yes.
For us. And if you see, it also has Venus and Mercury in its fifth house of application of learning. So, and Mercury, Venus is also one of those planets, like, it gives you everlasting fifth house of power, also fifth house of prestige. So Venus gave her an everlasting prestige and power. And fifth house of publication. Venus is the third lord of writing in the fifth house of publication. So she got so many books published. Mercury, again, the second lord of wealth, and the 11th lord of, again, wealth in the fifth house of power, publication, learning, applied learning, all those things. And she has done that well. So in a chart, what happens is not everything, the nakshatras, the planets, the signs, all will give you a combination for some very important event or some very important thing in your life to happen and prosper. Anything that is stray and solitary will not find a huge expression, but anything that is emphasized time and time again by many planets, nakshatras, or by signs, houses, that thing is definitely to take you to a big height. Like you said about the previous chart.
Yeah, I'm seeing the Kendra. I mean, all the four friends are sitting there.
Yeah. So, and sun and, moon sitting there, right there in the Kendra. And Jupiter. Yeah. So, and Mars. And yes, all belonging to the same family. And retrograde Mars, so it gave her, in her career, first, it did not take her to big heights. Slowly and steadily, she moved into big heights, and she was able to channelize her anger, her frustration in life into ink, which Mars represents, into her profession.
Fantastic, this is.
So, as I said, everything makes it up. The best part about, astrology is that all roads lead to the same room. So we will have a lot of people who would be good lawmakers, and lot of people who will be accomplished physicians, and then filmmakers. All of them will show a strong Pushya. Not all, I mean, it's not very important that all of them show a strong Pushya, but Pushya does help them in this journey of becoming accomplished more and more because of its values, because of its powers. So we have another person here, Sanjay Dutt. Sun and Pushya So Sun is a very, as I've always stated, the biggest